Hey folks, thanks for tuning in to Samosa Chai with .NET. Third episode already.
There's a voice coming back.
Third episode.
You probably have kept the YouTube also on, I guess. Well, it's the third episode, so we are still learning as well. And now you're muted, Vivek. So Vivek, can you hear me?
Yeah, can you hear me? Better
yes,
now?
Yes, now you can.
Yeah, there was some background there, man. Sorry, yeah. There is some background. I'm in an office, and yeah. I have a screen in front of me, a big screen where I have connected to the big screen. Nice. So sorry for the trouble, the startup. And by the way, folks who don't know me, I'm Vivek, senior cloud advocate. Cloud and AI engineering. Hey Nish,
hello,
how are you?
And my name is Nish. Yes, I'm really doing good, and I work on the community team talking about developer stuff, .NET architecture and things like that. If you've seen us do these episodes, my mission over here is to teach Vivek as much .NET as I can, so that he is equipped to do all the awesome things that he wants to do, and then spread this message too, right, Vivek?
Right, perfect. So, I'm at office, by the way. So you asked me about the background. Yes, I'm at office, and you can see this nice place where we all used to have tea. You know, if you remember,
yeah,
this is the place where we all have tea. So what's up today? You know, where is James? Let's bring in James.
Sure. Hello, James.
Hey,
good morning.
Yes, good afternoon.
Good morning.
Yes, thank you. Yes, bright and early over here in the western part of America. It's 3 a.m., so very excited to have woken up. And I know probably Nish was probably freaking out probably around 4 o'clock your time, just to make sure that I actually got online. So
yes, those who don't know, James and I are good friends, and he also happens to be my manager too. So, and he was off yesterday, so I couldn't get him on. So I dropped a message to James saying, hey, you know what, come 15 minutes earlier so I can be sure that my manager turns up on the show.
It's early. You never know. I mean, I went to bed around 10 last night, and then I was like, I'm going to wake up at 2 o'clock. And I set, 15 alarms. So as long as I have those alarms for every 5 minutes set, I was pretty good to go. So, but I think as long as I know that something is happening really early, like, when Nish and I would present so early in the morning, as long as you know there's something in the back of your mind that's like, I really got to be up. So no, I'm super excited to be here today. I do work alongside Nish. On the .NET community team, so helping developers be successful and building communities in and around .NET. So super excited to be here with you too.
And then, yeah, absolutely.
So James, you know about background about this Samosa Chai .NET, show. It's about basically, I am a beginner into .NET, and so I've been a hardcore Python developer. I've been a Java developer before, and I was having a conversation with Nish, like, how do I get started with .NET? Like, there are something new things happening, so how do I get started? And we said, okay, let's do something for the community as well. So while I'm learning, it's kind of, we are also teaching the community the .NET as well. So that's the background to the show, and obviously the samosa and chai comes to, like, for us, it's very important for us, the evening snacks for Indians, it's like samosa and chai. And I know you're a coffee person, but today we are going to, definitely, help you with some of the chai things, which we know. So I'm not sure whether, have you ever had a chance to have masala chai or anything?
Yeah. I mean, just last week I sent Nish some photos of some samosas that I had. I don't have chai here. I do have just normal tea. When I drink chai, the problem is, like, they keep refilling the chai so fast. You just keep drinking the chai nonstop, especially when you go to a good restaurant over here. We have some really good Indian restaurants in the area. So I don't have any chai at home, although maybe if Nish comes and visits here, if I go over there bring some actual real good chai back with me. So
you should be coming here, because that's when you will feel the authentic chai that you can. I mean, there are so many different variations of chai. I think we discussed about this in the first episode. I think we talked about chai from north to south. There are different variations to it. You know, the black teas, and there are different variations within the black tea, and in the chai itself, there are different ways people make it, and each one tastes, you know, extremely different. And you know, I kind of like all of them. I like to try things, and it's just really, really nice. But everything about coffee is something which I came to know through you, because you know, I know about coffee, like we all drink coffee.
Yeah.
But the fanatics over coffee is something which I learned it from you. And then I watch a lot of YouTube videos who they do this, all this coffee B-rolls. And, you know, the beauty of making the craft in coffee is really, really amazing. And how people choose the beans to, you know, choosing the grinding techniques and things like that. Yeah. I wish someday we have that with chai. Sorry, go ahead.
I feel like that's the same with chai in a way. I mean, maybe it's not as much for the, you know, actual like roasting part of it, obviously, and the grinding part of it, because it's very different between like a chai and this. But I think there's probably something magical to like how people steep the tea and how they mix in the different, you know, things together with it.
Yeah.
I mean, I think with coffee, it's unique because it's the same thing, right? Like wherever you, there's this video, I'll have to find it and send it to you, but there's this video kind of like coffees around the world, and like every country, just the concept of, oh, here's this bean, about how they roast the bean or how they make the coffee, has all very different variations. Like I roast some beans at home as well, and then have different setup. You know, the cool part about, I think, coffee, at least for me, is that you can have the same bean, like here's the same roasted bean, and you can make it in four different ways, and it's going to taste different every single time, subtly, like super subtly. But if you just do a machine, right, you click a button and a machine does it, completely different than if you do a pour over, or you do a Chemex, or you do an AeroPress, or
French press,
French press, or something like that. They're all different, and it's cool to like experiment with coffee as well. And I know a lot of my friends, they drink a lot of tea, and they do the same thing. As with tea, it's like it's a temperature thing. Like, not only is it the amount of tea, but the temperature that you have in. So beverages. That's you know, when I lived in Romania for a while for work, and it was like all the coffee that they had was very much like a little tiny espresso machines, and you would just like press a button, it would drop a little plastic cup, and it would fill it with espresso, and that was their coffee. So finding an actual like long coffee, like a, you know, normal black coffee, was really, really rare. But just different culture, because everyone would go to the train stop every morning, and it would be, you know, like 5 cents or 10 cents and to get a coffee, and it was just a different experience, right? That was coffee to them. So I'm sure it's the same with chai, right? There's different chai probably experiences throughout all of India too.
Yeah, it does. And also the quantity. I think when I came to the US for the first time, I was like, the coffee that everyone drinks there, the amount is like huge.
Yeah.
And we are used to this small little chai thing, like, you know, the glass. It's very little. And so I think that's also differs in a lot ways, and I'm still figuring it out. I can drink coffee and chai, like I don't have any like any particular taste over it. What about you, Vivek? I mean, you too, right?
Yeah, I mean, I do. I mean, like I like coffee too, and definitely chai. And today morning I had coffee and chai both. Like morning when I came into office, I had coffee.
Why not?
And when you left, I had tea. So that's the whole thing. So before we, you know, jump into the deep discussion on the tech side of it, you know, I just want to talk about a little bit of a code of conduct of this event, and just give the, you know, for the audience, let me share this on the screen. So let us spend some, you know, a minute on the code of conduct, which covers this event. You know, make sure that you're very respectful for the people. And while you're asking questions, we will make sure that we answer all your questions. Don't worry. And you know, put your views in a point where you don't hurt people. So spend some time. I've posted the link as well in the chat where you can go through this code of conduct in detail as well. So let me come back to this. So James, so it's So it's today with, you know, the MAUI, right? So I am a beginner. I'm basically a very newbie for even for mobile app development. Okay, so I want to, you know, start with what is a native app, right? When somebody talks about like native apps and, you know, building something native and other things, what is that native apps is? I want to start the discussion with that. And obviously, you know, we will go in depth into the demos and other things, but
yeah,
with that native apps, it would be a great help for me.
Yeah, you know, I think when I think about building mobile and desktop applications, you know, that's sort of my background. I'm not really a web developer at all, though I can develop web applications, but I started as a desktop developer building Windows applications, you know, out of university. And that was really something I really fell in love with. And I think when I got my very first phone, so I got like my first Android phone in my hand, I really fell in love. This was, you know, 10, 12, 13, I don't know, so many years ago now, but I really fell in love with the actual device and the software. And I remember the first time that I found that I could, you know, make a program for this thing, just like I was building programs for Windows. I thought that was a really special moment, especially that I could do it in C#. So I think what the distinguishing part of native applications is, there's a few different aspects. And, you know, there's a range that you're going to need for your app. Every app, everything that you build, everything you do, right, has different requirements, whether that is, hey, I need specific features for this application that requires device capabilities, or I need a specific look and feel. So when I think about native devices and native applications, I really think of like three things, which is, you know, the app has to be really fast. It has to have native performance. You know, you want to click a button, you need to have it start up really quick. You want to be able to scroll through things and be very responsive. You need the app to, you know, look and feel correct based on your design, but based on the platform too. I think most individuals, they, you know, buy an iPhone or an Android device or use a Mac or use a Windows device because they like the look and feel of the device that they're buying, but they also like the operating system and the look and feel of the operating system. So they want their apps to be, you know, pretty native, you know, as far as the look and feel of what Apple or Google or Microsoft wants applications on their platforms to look like. So a little toggle or switch looks like a toggle or a switch in all of your applications on that platform. And then I think, you know, lastly, you want access to those, you know, native capabilities. So, for example, if you need access to get someone's geolocation, or you need to do Bluetooth, or, you know, even just simple things like saving a password in the keychain, you want access to those native capabilities. So I think those three things are things that probably Nish and I have been talking about for native mobile applications for the last decade, and I think still run true, because there are things that you can do out of just a website. You know, there's access to some geolocation, and there's access to a few, you know, storing caches and things like that. But actually getting down and saying like, hey, I want to connect to Bluetooth and I want to receive updates, or I want to receive updates to geolocation in the background. Those are things that you'll need out of a native application that you want to deploy, you know, to your users. Now, of course, you know, that's one extreme. And then the other extreme is like, hey, I just have, you know, my web app, and I just want to put it into a shell of a native application. And we actually have the capability of doing that too. Does that make sense, Vivek, about like kind of like the native bits and pieces? Oh, you're muted there.
You're muted.
Oh. So basically, if I have if I have the WhatsApp app, so I want WhatsApp to use the native platform look and feel. If I'm installing the app on, in an Android phone or into the iOS, so that the look and feel is quite different, and want to make sure that it has to be the same. So that's what MAUI will help me to build it. And also, I can have web app on web components as well. So that's good. Okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah, and I think like that's the thing that sort of .NET is really about, right? Is enabling you to build for what you need to. So if you need a web application, you need a mobile application, you need a desktop application, or maybe you just need a mobile application and that's it, based on your needs, you can build that and share code between all of your applications.
Right. So let's deep dive.
Just a quick thing. We should ask users to send us their questions, because we got James here. So we will ask those questions for you live. And if you're watching on YouTube, post them on the comments. We will be able to ask that. If you are anywhere else, use a hashtag, SamosaChai maybe, and then we will bring those questions in into this chat. So
yeah.
All right. I think we have our first question here. James, is for you. Comet and drone controls are experiments. Any plans? Yeah. What makes it to .NET 7?
Perfect. Well, let me get into like what .NET MAUI is first, and then we'll talk about .NET 7 features. How about that?
Yeah, I thought about that too. Yeah, let's get into what .NET MAUI is, and then see what .NET 6 brings us, and totally. Then we'll get into .NET 7.
Cool. Yeah, I have a few slides, and I have some demos, and then I'm also, like you can see here on the title slide, I am going to talk a little bit about Blazor. So also, you know, I think that what's an important part about flexibility when you're thinking about picking a platform is that, you know, every developer is a little bit different. Some developers are back-end developers, or front-end developers, or client developers, or microservice developers, or AI machine learning developers. You want to be able to like share the language between all of them, but you also want to mix and match. So I think like that is sort of the big draw of .NET all up, right? Is that you can basically use all of your knowledge, all of your libraries to build for any of these different platforms, whether it's cloud or web or desktop or mobile specifically. And there's a huge ecosystem with NuGet and GitHub and Visual Studio and VS Code and the CLI that you can use for all these things. So this is a slide that we show all the time, which is true. And it's like why I really enjoy being a .NET developer. But, you know, I think like what's interesting is that there's a lot of different use cases for different applications and different needs that, from retail to agriculture to basically any business can imagine, you know, needing to build applications for all sorts of different platforms, right? And you also need to think about like your users too. Platforms that are native, for example, will take advantage of native accessibility capabilities of the device, like screen readers and different accessibility features for all different users. So I think about this as when we think about our users today, that are out there, there's all of them, right? There's kids, there's my grandparents, there's my parents, there's my sister, there's my, you know, niece and nephew, right? Everybody here is on all of these different platforms that are out there. So I think that when we look at the ecosystem, it's important to realize that, you know, all of these platforms are really important. So of course, there's like tons of different ways of building for these different platforms, right? So there's the native approaches with Swift and Objective-C and Java or Kotlin, or there's C++, or there's, you know, JavaScript frameworks, and there's all these different things out there. But of course, as .NET developers, we want to be able to build for all of those different platforms and for all different users, right? Maybe and wherever we're deploying, we might have more Android users. So we want to, you know, target that first, but we want to make sure that we have the capability to go to iOS and desktop later on. So I think what's great though is that our goal is being able to deploy to these platforms, but also leverage the ecosystem of .NET developers that are out there, right? There's nearly 6 million .NET developers in the world that are building for all these different platforms. So you really want to take advantage of that great ecosystem. And what's funny is when you're asking about native, like I literally had this slide, which is, you didn't even ask me about, beforehand about native stuff. But, you know, I think that the pillars of this native development is this. It's the things that have really rung true over the time is those different bits and pieces. So when our team set out to, the Microsoft .NET team and the .NET MAUI team and the Xamarin team set out to build something, you know, they want to make sure that all three of these pillars are met, and that also that the native performance is met. So actually how we think about applications is we think of it just as there's a base platform, just like there's a Windows platform today, there's a Mac platform today, and there's also iOS and Android. So with .NET and specifically .NET 6, there is .NET for iOS and .NET for Android. So that is like the core underlying system to build applications. And that's sort of a one-to-one mapping to like Swift and Kotlin development for iOS and for Android. So if you wanted to, you know, really just get access to the raw APIs of iOS and Android, you have access to those in C Sharp, which is really cool, and Mac, of course, too. And we have native compilation bits and pieces for every single aspect for that. Now, traditionally, though, you'd build your application different languages, different UIs, you know, over and over again. So what we aim to do is simplify that and create a cross-platform UI layer and framework for developers. And that's .NET MAUI, which is the .NET multi-platform app UI, which is part of .NET 6. And includes your ability to build Windows applications, Mac applications, iOS applications, and Android applications. And what's cool here is you get a cross-platform native UI, single project, single code base. You can deploy to multiple targets. And it's going to be coming out in general availability next year. So Q2 2022 is the target of it. And while it is in preview today, which is what I'll be showing, there are definitely companies out there that have been shipping in GA or general availability. So there's actually .NET MAUI apps on the App Store today already. We may not officially recommend that because, you know, Microsoft's stamp of approval support policy is there. But hey, it's open source. You can do whatever you want. It's you live your life. That's what I like to say. And I'm this holiday, this Christmas and New Year's, I'm going to be trying to upgrade some of my applications as well, which is really cool. So, and what we think about it too is like, it's great that there's a UI platform for building applications. But what we really want is for developers to feel super productive to create these native performant applications. And that's what I think is a real highlight of .NET MAUI, is not only the ability to actually build an application that runs and looks native, but also looks, you know, basically similar across the different platforms, but also the, you know, entire development experience feels productive from start to finish as well, which is kind of cool. So let me kind of like walk through what that looks like in building like a first app here. So I'm going to come in. Go ahead. Yeah.
So before we go there, James, just if you go back to the slide.
Yeah.
Just a back one, the slide where you were talking about the one back to this. Yeah, here. So, I mean, I'm trying to just understand that you have .NET 6. And once you have the .NET 6, you have the complete package to build any application on these different native UI, I mean, OSs, right? I mean, the iOS, Mac, and Android. So I just need .NET 6. And after that, I have all the controls to do that.
Yeah, totally. So like when you go in to Visual Studio, so if I pull up like the Visual Studio installer today, since it's in preview, you need the Visual Studio preview to do it. So here I have the Visual Studio 2022 preview, and I can show you what this looks like. I'll just hit modify here. But basically, how .NET 6 is broken up is between like core and core platforms, and then additional workloads. So web is an additional workload, and mobile is an additional workload, and Windows and UWP are additional workloads. So right now, when you just install .NET 6, you get sort of, you know, base .NET 6 things. And then if you want to do web development, you install the web workload, and you install the mobile workload. And if I log in or zoom in here, you'll see that there's this .NET MAUI preview. So if you just go in into Visual Studio 2022 preview, basically you install the .NET MAUI preview, and that gives you everything that you need to get started with it. And then in the future, once it's in, you know, general availability, then it'll be that additional downloader. Right? Because I think that's the thing, is you don't want just the normal install of .NET 6 or .NET 7 or .NET 8. To give you everything, you want to kind of pick and choose based on what you want to develop. So the goal is that developers can install .NET, and then there'll be like optional workloads that you would install. Say, hey, I want to do .NET MAUI development. Let me install that workload. And Visual Studio, you know, does it for you. But you can also install it from the command line too. So it's very flexible.
Yeah, while we are on this, you know, I've heard about Xamarin forms as well. So it's also open source, and I hear about MAUI now. You know, both have similar kind of features. So what's the difference between both, and why this was needed as open source? Even both were open source, right? So
yeah. Yeah, so Xamarin Forms has been around for, I think, 6 years now, which was our original cross-platform UI framework for developers to use. Super successful, hundreds of thousands of apps and developers using Xamarin Forms today in production, still a GA product and supported for many, many years. .NET MAUI is the evolution of Xamarin Forms. So it's like the kind of like the next version, but it's really a fundamental shift under the hood. So because, you know, once UI frameworks get older, you know, as well, they need to evolve. And because iOS, Android, Mac, and Windows are all evolving too, right? We have, well, I'm on Windows 10 here. I have a lot of machines on Windows 11. You know, my iOS is on iOS 15. And when Xamarin Forms was created, it was like iOS 8. And, you know, seven versions of iOS have come out. So there's so much legacy that was in there that the team said with .NET 6, which was this unification of .NET, let's rethink from the ground up how to rebuild something new, leveraging all of that knowledge for developers that they've had to make apps more performant, smaller, and also improve just the development experience. So overall, what's great too is that if you're a Xamarin Forms developer, you can actually migrate. And I have a slide in here later on that I'll talk to. And there's a tool, a command line tool, the .NET Upgrade Assistance, that will help migrate your code automatically. But if you have Xamarin Forms today, you know, I have a lot of apps in the App Store today, and I'll continue to use them. So yeah, but you can totally migrate over time, just like you can migrate existing like .NET framework applications to .NET 5 or .NET 6. You want to kind of move with it. So yeah, this was one where the team really was like, hey, this is going to be a bigger, you know, project, but there's going to be a lot of advantages for developers since it's going to be built from the ground up.
All right. Cool. James, I have some more questions lined up. Sure. Are you okay to take it now?
Yeah.
So the first question from Anoop, can we use MAUI to do production ready application now?
You totally can if it fits your need. We recommend official Microsoft is .Xamarin Forms would be the official production because it's GA and as a support policy. Just right now, since .NET MAUI is in preview products don't have a support policy. So that would, you need to take that into consideration, basically.
Right. And we have another question. Any profilers for MAUI?
That's a great question. The Xamarin team had profilers. I believe that's a good question for Maddie, because I think Maddie is working like with the Visual Studio like profiler teams, like make it one profiler. So I'm not really sure what the finalized plans are for that, but it's, yeah, definitely more of an advanced topic.
Cool. The next question is, do we have any guidelines to migrate WinForms desktop applications to MAUI?
That's a big one. Well, it depends what you need, right? So I would say based on like, if your WinForms application only needs to stay on Windows, you may just want to look at like upgrading your WinForms application to .NET 6, you know, get a lot of advantages, performance, deployment, resolution upgrades. If you do need to upgrade from WinForms to anything else, right? So WPF or .NET MAUI or Blazor, you'd have to, you know, look to recreate your UI. However, the biggest part for any migration, I think people have been asking this even for years, is mostly think about how your UI would look on a desktop or on a mobile phone, and try to, you know, plot out your screens that way. But take your common code base and put those into a standard .NET standard library or .NET 6 library. And then that way you can migrate that code over and include that into a .NET MAUI app. But the biggest part is start small and prototype things slowly but surely.
Yeah. Also, I think I just want to add on to this. We also have a book on modernizing desktop applications. So it does give you some guidelines on how to go about it. So so the thing is to understand here is every platform has its own native codes, the APIs that you will use. So if those are the ones which are baked in, that cannot be kind of like directly ported. So what you need to do is take take a common code, a shared code, put it in a .standard libraries, and then you can reuse the other things. You can reuse the shared code, right? So cool. Okay, next question.
I'm excited to see the demo, by the way. You know, it's so much of things there. You know, it's kind of fun to see. Yeah, there is one more question as well, right?
I'll take one more and then I'll let James do the demo.
Sure.
Can I mix in WinUI 3 for Windows?
Well, the cool part is .NET MAUI is built on top of WinUI 3. So I'll talk about this when I show the demo, but like when you create a button or a label or an image or things like that, those are the native WinUI 3 controls from the Windows app SDK. But you do have the ability to make, you know, if you have a like WinUI screen, you can reuse that in a .NET MAUI application as well. So if you can mix and match those XAMLs together, and you can do that with Xamarin Forms today as well. So yeah, totally.
Cool. James, cool. Go ahead. Share some demo.
Yeah, so I have quite a few demos. We'll see if we have time for all of them. But I'm just gonna start with something basically file new, walk through what this looks like. So I'm in Visual Studio, and over here I've just selected .NET MAUI. So here's all the different options. Here, normally when people come in, they have all their languages, and you just type in, you know, MAUI, for example, and then all the MAUI templates would come up here. So there's three different templates. We'll talk about the first one, which is the native UI, native .NET MAUI application. The .NET MAUI plus Blazor is a hybrid application. We'll talk about that later. And then there's just like a library to help you share code across the different platforms. So I'm just going to create a cross-platform one. I'm just going to hit create. MAUI app 5 is a good name. So we'll do that. And what this is going to do is create a brand new project for me. And then it's going to give me all the code I need, basically, to get started with .NET MAUI. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to start to kind of like drop down and kind of like show you exactly what this looks like. So I think this is the cool part of .NET MAUI in .NET 6 is that you get just a single project over here. Let me close this really quick. Boop. So here is my .NET MAUI app. And you can see under dependencies that I have an Android dependencies, iOS dependencies, a Mac, and a Windows application here. And then I have inside of here all of any platform specific code. So there is a little bit of Android code, iOS code inside of here. And then I have other things such as fonts and images and app icons and my resources. And those are all cross-platform images. And then also my main page XAML, which is XAML is a markup language, kind of like HTML. And then my main program file here. So most of the time, developers just live in one project. Everything is here for them. And what's really cool about that is that if we actually go over to the debug menu, we can actually see that I can switch between my framework that I want to target. So is it Android, iOS, or Windows? And when I toggle it, see it like switch to Windows here. And when I go here, we have Android, we have iOS simulators, iOS remote devices. I can toggle it back to Android, and then it'll target and pick my Android emulator that I have up or my Android device that I may plug into my machine, which is really cool. And that's all from that one project. And that's something that's really new and really fundamental. But it's actually a lot more than that, too, because while I mentioned that there's these fonts and images, I'm just going to double tap on this project file and take a look at it, because I think this is really, really neat, is that what we'll see is that we have this multi-targeting here, which is basically saying, hey, there's one project, but it's going to be able to build for Android, iOS, Mac Catalyst, and then if you're on Windows, also add Windows as well. So that way you can open this on your Mac and it'll also open too. And there's a lot of cool things in here. So for example, it's using, you know, .NET MAUI, it's using single project, but there's also other cross-platform things. So things like your application title, your app identifier, your version number, these are all cross-platform. So previously you'd have to go worry about, you know, do I need to go update my Android or my iOS project or other things like that? But no, they're all in there. So you just set them in one place. So as you're working on your application, you set them in one place. You can specifically, you know, set for iOS what versions you support on Android and Mac and Windows, how far back you want to go. So you can set those in the cross-platform code. So you don't need to go into iOS or Android specific projects. Oops, there we go. And then
this blows
also,
my mind all the time when I see, because James, remember the time when we used to do this in multiple projects in settings?
Yeah.
iOS used to have its own plist file, Android has its own manifest file. And it was so difficult to do it. And now with multi-targeting, it just makes it super easy.
It makes it awesome.
I think even the DevOps for this, right? So like building, packaging it, and releasing these different packages, right? That also solves a lot of problems for DevOps engineers as well.
Totally. Yeah, exactly. Especially the versioning part of it. And yeah, just getting things built up. And I think as things are going, you'll see that there's a lot of other just, you know, cross-platform things for developers. So I think what this is cool here is this item group here is saying, here's additional cross-platform things. We talked about the app name, the package, you know, version number, but this is really cool because I talked about those resources and these two down here are saying, hey, go find any images inside of the images folder and automatically bring those into the project and resize them for me automatically for the different platforms. And additionally for custom fonts. So you have all your different custom fonts here. Those are all brought in automatically. You don't need to go and modify anything else. You just say, you know, you can specify a single image. So if I said, you know, niche.png and there was a niche PNG in my folder over here, it would totally bring that in. But I'm going to use the star, which says grab anything from the images folder and bring that in, which I think is really, really cool. But the two up top here are even better, which is app icon and splash screen. Yeah. So what's cool here is SVGs are supported. They're resized automatically. And what's cool is that you can just say, here's my icon SVG foreground and background. Here's the color of it and my splash screen logo, and just create it for me automatically. Just go off and do it. And it handles it for me all automatically just from those few lines of code. And this is using all the new .NET 6, you know, SDK project style. So it's very minimal, very easy to read, and everything is in one project, which is really cool.
So this is on the XML.
So this here is just the project settings. So every project that you create has this sort of setup. And this is just sort of telling the project what is in it and what to build. Now, if we do look at the XAML, the XAML here, we have this main page. So now we're actually talking about not the project settings, but the pages of our application. So I'm just going to hit debug here and it'll spin up and we can see exactly what the application looks like. And then we'll kind of walk through the UI. But what we can see is that we have this thing called a content page. And this content page is a page of our application. So we would create multiple content pages and navigate between them in our application. And then the root of my application is this scroll view. So there's a big scroll view. I have a bunch of content in here and I'm able to scroll up and down. And then I have some other things such as a label, another label, a bunch of labels and a button that says click me. And when I click it, it's going to increase the count, but I also have an image here as well. So we have quite a few different things that are inside of here. And we also have all sorts of different controls. So things like list views and collection views and buttons and toggles and all sorts of things that you could kind of think about. And I'll show a full application as well. That kind of shows what that looks like. So I hit that debug button, and what's cool is that this is actually compiling up and going through like a native compilation step and then deploying to my device. So here's that splash screen. So that was generated for me automatically, which is really cool. And then here's my application that says, hello world, welcome to .NET MAUI. and then the counter here. So we can see that we have this button over here, which is this purple button, and that's actually styled. So we actually have some styles, kind of like CSS in a way. So we can see here this button is saying, you know, use a specific color for the font, font family, background color is this purple here, and then padding on this button as well. So there's different, you know, settings that are being applied to this button and to every label. So I don't have to style every single one. But what's cool about this is that I can come in and just change any of these things. So I could say it's welcome to Samosa Chai. And I just hit save and we have hot reload built right in. So you can see it update right there, which is cool. We can make that bigger. So I can say 28 and that'll be really big, which is cool. And if I look at this button down here, we can actually see it's a native button because we're getting like these, it's going to be a little bit hard to see on the stream, but you get these little tiny animations that are built into Android that Android, you know, users are used to, this little ripple effect here. And that's all native that's built in. But when I tap on this, it increases this counter. And let me actually make even that counter bigger too. I'll make that 26 and see the state is saved. So it still says 6 there, which is kind of cool. I can tap around.
And then I'm just noticing that, you know, you're not even saving it. You're just making changes and, you know, it's just getting hot reload.
Just hot reloaded automatically. And then, yeah, you can see that there's this clicked property. So on clicked counter. So if anyone's built any application ever, there's these events. So what I did is I went to the code behind over here of the main page XAML CS, and there's this code behind. And what I did is the template just gives us this button counter that says, whenever I click it, increase the count by 1, so plus plus, and then set the text of the label. So there's a lot of different architectures that you can build in to .NET MAUI, such as MVVM, which is an architecture pattern, just like MVC is an architecture pattern for web developers. But you can just, you know, put code in your code behind and it totally works fine. And what's cool, since hot reload works in the XAML, it also works in the code behind too. So if I say plus equals 10, for example, up here, I'm going to hit this little hot reload button, and you can do that on save as well, but there's a little fire emoji up here. And when I do that, it's going to reload my code. So see how it increases by 10 every time. So I can actually adjust this, and I can adjust sort of anything inside of here too. So when I do this, now we can see the current count is over here too. So you can change your code that's running. I'm debugging the application live, and I can build my application out fully over here on the different platforms. So that's just, you know, one thing that's cool. But if I run this application on Windows, it's going to look different too. So let me pull back up the application here and rerun it. So here's our icon, the .NET icon. And now what I'll do is I'm going to drop down over here in my toolbox, and I'm going to say, hey, go and deploy on Windows. And that will basically change my application to now deploy on Windows. And that uses the native UI stack. So WinUI 3, part of the Windows App SDK. And on Android, it's the native Android material design. And now what this will do is it will go ahead and build up my native, you know, actual Windows application over here and debug it up here as well. So let's see what that looks like here. As soon as it deploys, there we go. Perfect. So it's a little bit larger of a screen. You can say I can kind of resize it here. And this has the bigger changes because everything was hot reloaded. So it wasn't, you know, wasn't redeployed in the application, but you can see like here's the native buttons. So they have the native non-rounded corners on Windows. I'm in a Windows frame that can be resized, obviously, here as well. And of course, I can do all of my XAML hot reload and changes if I wanted to as well on here. And then if I look, it's obviously been installed as well into my Windows application because it's actually Windows that's running here. So you get, you know, that same exact application across the different platforms. And I didn't write any Windows or iOS or Android or different code in there. It's all this one XAML and this one bit of logic that is letting .NET MAUI do that heavy lifting under the hood of creating and figuring out what native UI to display. Now, if you really wanted to, you could come in here and you can, you know, access, you know, the actual platform folder. So for example, like on Windows, there is some like Windows code in here because it's like starting up the Windows shell of an application. And we can see it says like create MAUI application. And like there is 35 lines of Windows code in here. And the team's always working to make that smaller, which is cool. And same thing on Android. Like on Android, there's this main activity and it's literally 11 lines of code. And in the next preview 11, this is preview 10 right now, this will be even shorter because it uses a bunch of new .NET 10 or C# 10 features. So same thing here is that if I wanted to, I can come in and write Android code. So like we can see there's Android namespaces. So if I said, you know, using Android.Bluetooth, for example, I could access Bluetooth inside this application using the Android APIs that are there too. But you know, I think what's more important is that while you have access to those main APIs inside of these different projects, and if you want to, you can go write that Android code and create dependency injection and stuff like that. We actually have cross-platform native capabilities inside of .NET MAUI, which is called .NET MAUI Essentials. So let me show you what that looks like. For example, if I wanted to come into this page, and let's say I wanted to check connectivity, we can see this is using Microsoft MAUI Essentials. So let me zoom in here because I think this is neat. And I'm actually going to change my setting because this thing follows me. I hate when it follows me. Where's the... don't follow me ever. There we go. That's like a newer feature, which I think is awesome, but then also not great too. Well, actually, I need it to probably do a few settings.
Reset this thing, yeah.
I need it to, funnily enough, I did turn off one too many setting, which is I need it to follow my mouse pointer. There we go. So it actually moves. There we go. Perfect. So I can come in and check this out. If I come in and say, Microsoft.MAUI.Essentials, this is kind of cool because you can see that inside of here, there's all sorts of different classes in here, such as accelerometer, barometer, app information, battery information, clipboard, compass, connectivity, contact information, email, file pickers, geolocation, location settings, maps, media pickers to pick images. You know, there are all these cross-platform APIs, just like we have cross-platform UI, we have cross-platform native APIs inside of here. So if we did, for example, connectivity dot, let's say network access, let's just check to see if we have internet. And if we do, what I'll do is I'll say display alert. So I'll display a pop-up and I'm going to say you have internet here. I'll say thumbs up. There we go. And I'll say okay. Here, right? So I'll do a little pop-up here. And what I'll do is I'm going to go in and I'm just going to run this again. So now that we have this new code in here. I stopped debugging, so I guess I could have hot reloaded that too, but since I didn't, I put it here. So we're going to, you know, check the connectivity of this device here. So let me just go ahead and click this button. You know, I'm debugging my application, and you can see this actually shows me that I have internet access, which is cool. If I actually go into that, you can see that it says internet there. And then I'm just going to go ahead and F10 over that, and then we can see that it hit it correctly. So I can actually then get that pop-up. And then here we get the native pop-up. So it says you have internet and you know you get the thumbs up and you're totally good to go, which is really cool. And that same exact code works across iOS, Android, Mac, Windows, all those different things. So you have access to all those APIs that are readily available to you, which is really, really cool. So it's not only about the cross-platform UI, but it's also about the cross-platform API access. Like, if I wanted to, I could go and actually look at it. So for example, if I go into github.com/.net/MAUI, I can go into source, I can go into essentials. And if I look at this code for connectivity, for example, here, we have all the code that was written for you. So here's Windows and all this code, right? When I actually hit where was it at? Right here. When I hit this network access code, you can see that it went off and it's using native Windows APIs to get the internet connectivity profile, check to see what level I'm at, and then sort of normalizes that back down to say, am I on local internet, constrained internet? And it does the same thing for Android or for iOS or for Mac. So all of this code that you don't have to write because the team has already written it for you automatically. Like, Android's very complex. As you can see, it's hundreds of lines of code that you don't have to write for it.
I saw some java.lang there inside.
Yeah, there's all sorts of, Android's really crazy. It's the backwards, it's a mess. There's all sorts of crazy stuff that can happen inside this thing. So that's the cool part of it, right? Is it's really simplifying, not only like, hey, here's how I build a UI inside of here, but here's how I get, the native looks and feels of it. So a good example here, let's put a switch in here. I'm just gonna put just a switch. And I think that's a good example of probably like what a native, look and feel is. And if I ran this on Windows 11, it would look a little bit different there too. So I put a switch, it's in the top left corner here, so you can kind of see it. So it's a Windows switch that I'm tapping on. I probably should set the different background colors here, but you can kind of get the look and feel of, oh yeah, that's a switch that, that's what it looks like on Windows there. Now, if I set this to run on Android, for example, and I start this up, here, so this is my old one, so let's go ahead and get rid of that one. This will now rebuild the Android application, so you can see it's going through some steps. It's a lot faster the second time because it just has to do a diff. But we can see here that I should probably change it from white because it's really hard to see. So let's do that actually and go back in here and say color. Let's see, I don't know, red. Let's see what that looks like. And it didn't seem to. Oh, I'm not debugging. So let me go actually and debug this, and we can actually see it change colors as well. I was trying to be faster even than it's actually super fast. Look how fast that is.
Yeah, it's funny, Yeah, completely. I'll talk about that.
Yeah, I'm always like, oh my goodness, that. I'm always like, oh, it took so now we can see like the colors here toggle. But that's vastly different than the Windows look and feel, because this is an Android switch and toggle that I have going on as well. So makes sense.
Yeah. So as I want to talk about the hot reload thing, I don't know how many people really appreciate what that really brings to the table. And like when I joined Xamarin like about 8-9 years ago, I had this. I was the evangelist for this side of the world, so I used to go train a lot of people. And those were the days when even Xamarin, Intel Xamarin never were just picking up, or people didn't have it. And we used to have this emulator running, and we used to train like 25, 30 people in a class how to write Android apps and all those things. And if you just make some change into it and then you want to debug again, the number of minutes it took, that was like crazy. And look at the productivity that we're talking in 2021. It was just like, just save it and then just there, right? Go fix that margin error or the padding error that was like, that took ages to figure it out, like where exactly that needs to make a change to, in order to get the output that we really want. So it's really amazing,
Yeah. So here is a funny part, Nish. So that is the reason I waited for .NET 6 to come to start learning,
Yeah.
It gets easier for me to learn, right?
That is true. Yeah. Imagine 5 years from now, then.
Yeah.
We will be having all of the Windows, the macOS, all of it in one place, and we'll be writing in one small window of code, and everything will be, you know, refreshing and maybe just, and then commit, and then everything just gets published using DevOps, right?
So yeah.
It's really amazing.
And, you know, you with this, you can build full applications too. So I just kind of like showed like the file new, but like we actually built this entire like big podcast application for .NET Conf, our big conference. And I'll kind of like show what that looks like, because I think what's cool about it is that you have here is a full .NET MAUI application. So we can see like custom controls, we have a player control, we have converters, we have a bunch of pages, we have services like, you know, audio player and Wi-Fi options and code behind all. Like, so this is kind of like what a full application would look like is kind of a whole bunch of code. And here's actually what this application looks like on my Android device. And I'm going to boot it up here on Windows as well. I'm pretty sure I deployed it here on Windows. There we go. So you can actually see what it looks like side by side. So there's like a full application over here on both iOS and Android. And it's a full application. So I can come in, I can tap on a podcast. This is calling a real service backend. So I have my subscriptions here. I can come in, I can listen to a podcast, which will start streaming it from the internet. Same thing here on Windows. I can come in, listen to the podcast. I get the player here. Now it's in my ears, so I'm gonna pause it. And there's all sorts of nice things here too. So if I come in and I, you know, add that podcast to my subscription, I get my podcast in here. You know, same, you kind of get that same exact look and feel. You can add podcast episodes to be listened to later or share them. You know, you get different links here. So I get the listen later views. I have dark mode as well. So I can toggle between my different views of my application here. So you can get that kind of look and feel that you're looking for. So you get these really full applications. Which is really, really nice. And this application was written completely with .NET MAUI and .NET 6 is what we sort of showed off just a few weeks ago at .NET Conf. So you kind of get that feel for, okay, it can do a lot more than actually, you know, simple hello world applications inside of here. And what's cool about this application too is that it's a full application. And it does take access to some of those native capabilities. Like, so for example, there's actually like a media player capabilities here that are using the native Android listen playback capabilities of Android. So, you know, not every API is cross-platform, but you have access to the native underlying platforms there, which is cool. But, you know, you kind of get that feel for like, okay, like you can build real things that are, you know, look and feel and are productive inside of Visual Studio. So you kind of get that full gambit of building applications with .NET MAUI.
Yeah, and I
think so when you build this application, you can package this application as, say, for example, if I have to release an Android app. Mm-hmm. So how do you package this application for an Android app? Like, is because I need an APK, right? So how do I do that?
Yeah, so inside of Visual Studio, so right now it's basically command line to be able to package up different things, but basically we'll have like right click publish or right click archive, and it will actually go through this process of basically archiving up an app, giving you an Android bundle, and then you can distribute it to the App Store or just on your machine right from Visual Studio. But most people do it from DevOps. So in Azure DevOps, GitHub, or App Center, you can just put that app in there and then it'll create the Android app bundles for you, iOS bundles for you, Windows bundles for you, and then you upload it to the app stores. So yeah, that process, some of the UI work is being done, but right now you can just, you know, basically in your CI pipeline, put it in there as well, which is kind of cool.
Yeah, I think I'll take a quick question here. Sanby asks, are MAUI apps much larger and more memory hungry than custom compiled native apps? I'm not sure what custom compiled native app is. Oh, I guess maybe native platform apps?
Yeah, that's a good question. So the team has been really, when you introduce any framework, whether it be .NET MAUI, Xamarin Forms, React Native, Flutter, anything, right? There's obviously something built on top of the native platform. So there's always going to be overhead, whether it's increase of some sort of your application or some, different implications of memory. I wouldn't say memory hungry at all. The .NET runtimes that are optimized are super streamlined and optimized for your application. I've been building apps with .NET for iOS and Android for 10 years. I've never had any issues with app size, and I've never had any issues with memory ever in my entire life. You can always, get yourself into trouble, I'm sure. The team has been really focusing on shrinking that app size and really optimizing it. So the startup time is like under like 1 second from like when you click on a release there. And then, nowadays, iOS and Android, they optimize your app. So even if I build and compile up an application that's maybe like 20 megabytes for Android, when you deliver that with app bundles to your users, they only get like 10 or 12 megs. It's already optimized. It splits it up and splices it up. So since it compiles down there, it works the same. Yeah. So to me, I wouldn't say they're more or worse at all. I mean, in any way, as far as app size or app performance, the goal is to get it as small as possible and fast as possible. And again, you probably have .NET applications on your phone already, and you probably don't know. So that's the goal.
One more question. Sandmi asks, can we develop MAUI app via VS Code?
Yeah, good question. So our official support and official, like, all in all for everything is with Visual Studio, because that'll bring in everything. But there's nothing stopping you from using VS Code or your other favorite code editor or command line. The one thing to check out, though, is a project, someone mentioned it earlier, called Comet. And this is a VS Code extension. So github.com/.NET/Comet. That's a public repo. And this is an MVU toolkit. And it actually works with VS Code and Hot Reload and everything like that. So there's all sorts of cool stuff in here. So you can actually take a look at that. It's a little bit different. So it's a code-first approach compared to XAML. But there's that. The thing with Visual Studio, it's going to give you all the XAML tooling, XAML Hot Reload, things like that, that are built into Visual Studio. There's .NET Hot Reload and then XAML Hot Reload. And .NET Hot Reload, that's for the code, that's part of .NET. But the XAML Hot Reload is part of Visual Studio. So, but definitely look at this, because this is, kind of built for, built for VS Code and code first development. Yeah.
Yes. Since we are on the comment, I'll just bring in the earlier question, which is, what are our plans there? And will this be available in .NET 7?
I'm not really positive. The team wants to ship the first version of it. You know what I mean? First, that's probably more important. I think mostly based on feedback from our developers in the community, what they're using, I think that'll be super important. As well, there's a lot going on with just .NET MAUI and a few other things too that I'll talk about if we have a few minutes too, with like web development to build mobile applications. But I think that let us know, use the projects and be active on it. And I think whatever developers are leaning towards that, and then whatever the time frame looks like, that's how they'll go for sure. Yeah,
cool.
So do you want to talk about one more thing, Nish? You ready for this?
Yeah, good.
So now, Vivek, I talked to, there's a lot of XAML here, there's a lot of XML, things like this. Now, one thing that we really want to do is we want to enable more developers to build native applications or even build hybrid applications, okay? So in .NET MAUI, you can actually combine together Blazor, which is our web app framework, to build web apps with Razor and HTML. It's part of ASP.NET Core. So this is actually really neat, because I mentioned earlier at the beginning that .NET or mobile and desktop and all those applications, everything's going to be flexible based on your needs. You might want native APIs and native UI absolutely everywhere, or you may be a web developer and you're like, hey, I can style my web application to look great and look the same on every platform. And there's a bunch of applications that do that as well. Or you're just like, I want to use web development, but still take advantage of all that cool stuff James showed, like connectivity and all this other stuff. So that's why we have this project template called .NET MAUI Blazor. And this is a hybrid application. I'm just going to create a new one. It uses all of the .NET MAUI single project goodness, but it adds the capability of blending in Blazor Web UI into a native desktop and mobile application. So notice here, I have MAUI app 6, and I have all my different platforms. It's going to bring in and restore all my NuGets. And then down over here, I have a few more files. So I still have my main page XAML that I actually can actually open up here. And we can note that we no longer have the labels and scroll views and buttons and things like that. We actually have a Blazor web view control. And that's going to bring in all of my Blazor web components in here that are built into this application. So if I had a Blazor application, I could put my entire Blazor, you know, pages and infrastructure in a Razor class library and add it into my .NET MAUI application here. So we can actually see the pages for my counter are HTML and Razor. So again, this looks a little bit different because it's not XAML. It's not going to render native UI. It's going to render web UI. However, down in here, I still have access to Microsoft.MAUI.Essentials.connectivity, for example. I have access to the native capabilities. And if I go over here, we still have our fonts, images, icons. I have my platform things inside of here, but I have a hybrid application. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually run this over on Android so we can actually see what that looks like compared to, you know, my native application. And we'll actually, you know, get this hybrid application. So what this Blazor app is, if I go into my index.html, we have a page that says, you know, survey prompt, how is Blazor working for you? We have a fetch data page, which is, you know, fetch forecast and loads data into a table. And then we have our counter page. So we actually have all the Blazor code and capability here, which is actually quite neat. So this is going to now compile up. And the reason for this is because, like I said, we want all developers to be able to take advantage of the capabilities of native applications, but use whatever, you know, web or native, you know, stack they feel comfortable using. So this is actually really cool. So let's see if it's going to boot up here. There we go. It's finishing. First one always takes a little bit longer, that first raw compilation. So let's have this boot up here. There we go. Booting up on my device.
So just to be clear on this, I mean, we're talking about having this HTML things running inside a mobile app.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So, and if developers are used to Blazor, where there's a Blazor server and a Blazor WebAssembly to run like on the cloud or in the client, you can think of Blazor hybrid as somewhere like in between, because it's in between because it, .NET is already built into the .NET MAUI shell of the application. So there is no server here. Like when I click on this counter, it's happening in the application. So we can see there's like this is just a bootstrap CSS button. You could use Fluent UI. You could use Material Design. There's all these different things out there. And I get this, you know, application, but I can take advantage of those native capabilities. If I run this over on like Windows, for example, too. So let me do that. I'm just going to debug it here. What I think is cool is that you're in control, right? You're in control of what this application looks like. And if you do want to use, you know, native buttons, you can put a native button inside of here, right? You can mix and match the UI between web and native controls here too. And we can actually do that and see what it looks like. So we have our, you know, we have our CSS is styling it here to say, hey, if it's so big or small, you know, show the little drop down here. But we can see on desktop, it gives us the full view over here. And when I drop it down, it automatically is just using just normal CSS, right? Just right here, which is kind of cool, which I think is really, really nice. Now, if I come in and I start to come in and I say, you know, stack layout, and I start to, we'll see if this breaks it or not. This hopefully it doesn't. I haven't done it in a while, but if I put a button in here and I say text, click me, let's see if that works. That should work. Let's do a grid, maybe a row definitions. Do grid row one. Let's see if that works. Let me redeploy it here, just see if it picks up the changes for me. So ideally, yeah, we should get this button. Let's see.
Yeah.
Oh, here we go. Oh, perfect. Okay.
There it is.
Yeah. There we go. Cool. So I get this click me button. So that's a big button that's there. And then I actually get my Blazor entire web app underneath there automatically, right? So that's a very, very simple example of like, hey, this is a native button. Looks very different than this button, and actually has like a little animation that plays when you click on it, compared to this button that's inside of this Blazor page. But it's cool because if I'm a web developer, I can now take advantage of all that native goodness, native cross-platform stuff, all those capabilities of .NET MAUI inside of this application, right? So for example, let me really spell this out for you, is that podcast app, we have a podcast app on the internet, and this is a full Blazor podcast app, you know, that looks and feels similar to the .NET MAUI one that I showed you, right? But it's fully web. It has different animations and CSS and styling. And if I actually bring it smaller, they actually styled it so the buttons are at the bottom down over here, and there's you know, different dark mode over here. But if I actually come over to this project, this one here is actually the entire Blazor app and a .NET MAUI wrapper around it. So if I actually run this, let me show this here, is that this app is just shove my entire Blazor app inside of a .NET MAUI application, which is cool. And here it is. So it's actually nice. a Blazor application inside of it here. So I actually get the responsiveness. I get everything I want automatically with CSS. The difference that I have is that in the .NET MAUI application, it's using native playback and capabilities, where this is just using standard web playback over here. Yeah. So I don't get necessarily all the native integrations and equalizers and all the different things there. I get a web control. So if I actually look at that, it's actually a JavaScript library. There's actually this audio interop here. And what that is doing is it's calling JavaScript to playback audio. So again, it's not like maybe the best experience, but man, if I'm a web developer, right, I can just take my app and then I could add native capabilities to it if I needed to over time. So that flexibility is super important.
Yeah, I think one thing we need to really mention here is that, I mean, if you're a web developer, you may be used to the HTML JavaScript side of the world. Mm-hmm. And what Blazor does is you have the HTML, but you have the C# side of the world, yes, which is what is, you know, making the web happen there. So everything that you see there is C#. So now when you take this to the mobile platforms, the C# that was already in and there is actually running on that native side of it as well. So you get real performance there. It's not running inside your browser. It's not the JS that is running inside the browser. which, I mean, historically we have had issues with those things, right? With JavaScripts and finding those errors and things like that. So this is running natively, and that's why you see how you know, you can easily use the platform capabilities of the MAUI essentials and things like that too, yep. Right?
Yeah, totally. So amazing. I think that's like a really cool just kind of introduction of the flexibility. And a lot of people love their XAML and they love their styling, but some people are web developers and they want to use their CSS and they want to use their HTML and take advantage of Blazor and the code, right? Because this is that counter code. It's all C++. And if you want to use JavaScript, you can, but you can try to stay in C# as much as you can. But maybe there's awesome, you know, libraries in Blazor today that you can already just use, and you can use them in a .NET MAUI application. You can deploy that, you know, anywhere, which is really cool. And that's a great way of getting to web and to desktop and to mobile as well from a single code base.
Right. And yeah. Also, I think just not to confuse people that, you know, if you are a mobile developer already, you don't have to jump on that side and say to build web. You're a web developer, right? Yeah, you pick that thing. For example, when we build the podcast app, I think we had this one module called Listen Together with James and Show today, but you should go check that out in the keynote demo we shared. I think that one was built on Blazor, and we didn't have enough time to build on the native platform, so we actually baked that in directly inside one of the tabs, and you would not even know that it's a Blazor app that's running inside it.
You can pick and choose. You want to go all native? Do you want to go all Blazor? Do you want to go hybrid? Do you want to mix and match a little bit here? It's a dial, right? You dial as much or as little as you want, which is cool. So if people want to get started as well with it, let me open another tab here and pull that up. The best way of doing it is if you go to github.com/.NET/MAUI, that's going to be the .NET MAUI repo here. And that's all open source. You can see everything here. Something was pushed 4 hours ago from Alon talking about Blazor WebView. There it is. And then there's a link right here to the document or dev blogs and documentation as well. So if you actually go down to the README, there's this getting started. So how to install .NET MAUI, documentation, samples, and things like that. That's the best place to get started. And you just click on it. It has the documentation and it shows you exactly how to get started and install and create your first project. So there you go. There you have it.
Amazing.
So while we are talking about that, probably, you know, next episode of Samosa and Chai, we will have Jeff here who will be talking on Blazor.
Nice. And that's awesome. So you can reuse all that knowledge that he gives you. Like, well, I can do this, I can do this, I can do this. The cool part about .NET, you can use those things together. I think that's what's cool.
Exactly. I hope we can get the full idea of that.
Yeah. One question I had for James was, how does people migrate now? So basically, you know, what is your suggestion for people who are already using the, you know, Xamarin forms, or probably they have different ways of doing it? So what is your strategy? What will you tell them? Like, how should they migrate into this?
Yeah, let me pull up my screen one more time here. You can bring it in there for me. So. Well, first, .NET MAUI Preview 10 is out today. There's new previews every month, so a lot of new stuff, and we can always read the blog. For migration, since it's built on top of Xamarin, right, there's going to be this proven track record that's out there, so it's the evolution of Xamarin. But there's this .NET Upgrade Assistant. So this is actually available today. It's in general availability. The .NET MAUI support isn't in there yet, but there is a branch that you can grab and try to migrate your code. Now, the .NET Upgrade Assistant works on all sorts of different applications, whether it be old web projects, WPF, WinForms application. They'll migrate to just the newest version of .NET 6 for that project type. But Maddie, who is our amazing PM on the .NET MAUI team, she actually ran the Upgrade Assistant on her plant application. She like waters plants and makes sure they don't die. But basically what she's doing here is she's going and calling upgrade on this project. It finds out everything about the project, asks you some questions, and then it will try to migrate as much code as it can via the command line, which is really, really cool. So it just kind of walks through doing that, and it'll tell you what it can change, what it can't change, what you can do automatically. And there'll be documentation for this. So this will probably get you 80 or 90% the way there based on your application. And then you can kind of go forward from that. And of course, like the thing to watch for is like, what does your application use, and have the third-party libraries upgraded to .NET MAUI. So for example, a lot of the MVVM frameworks and other third-party libraries have been upgraded to .NET MAUI, and things like Telerik and Sync Fusion and DevExpress, they're also upgrading too. And also we have this, oops, where'd that go? Oh my gosh, I clicked on a browser. There we go. Also, the .NET community or Xamarin community toolkit has also been upgraded too. So there's all sorts of things that you can basically make sure that the libraries you're using are upgrading, have been upgraded, and then is a good time to start kind of upgrading your application. And the cool thing is the team also, they also do live streams on live.net the first Thursday of every month. So they'll have one next week, which is cool. They kind of give status reports and all that type of stuff. So that's actually really cool to hang out with them. So the best place to do is check out the blog, check out the, you know, the community standups, and then mess around with the upgrade assistant when that's available.
Yeah. Very neat.
So I have one thing, you know, this is the Cloud Skill Challenge. Sorry, this is the Cloud Skill Challenge. Okay, so yeah, this is basically the Learn modules, which is been handpicked by Nish. So Nish has started, this is what you need to, you know, go through if you want to learn .NET and Xamarin Forms, Blazor. You know, you have to finish this collection. That is what he has created. So we have compiled the collection into Cloud Skill Challenge. So if anybody wants to get upskilled in all of these things, right? You know, this is where you go. You go to this, just go to this link, and you find all the Learn modules which has been handpicked. So that is where you get started. So just go there. Anything, Nish? I mean, I think there are some couple of questions.
Yeah. So James, we put together this entire thing for Vivek to gear up on .NET. And that's what we made this into a challenge as well. And Vivek still hasn't geared up yet. He's still rolling up there. We already have community people, you know, taking up this challenge and coming through, I guess, right? So
no, I did complete two. I did complete two. Two or one modules.
I know. Yes. I know. So these are really nice get started kind of modules, which will those of you who want to see how much you can do with .NET 6 and what all the it's not about just, you know, getting onto .NET 6, but also you choose the platform. There are learning materials there. So if you want to do just Blazor, there are learning materials for Blazor, right? Or you want to do MAUI, just like how James explained that today, you can do those things. And it comes with some really nice codes, samples that you can try. Maybe some of the even samples you can actually take it to the production as well. Some nice tricks that you have there for connectivity and other things that James showed today, right? Mm-hmm. So quickly taking this question, where can I find the code shown in the broadcast? For example, podcast apps? Well, James?
Working on it. Yeah.
Working on it.
So Nish and I specifically work with a team from Microsoft and from a really cool company called Plain Concepts. And we worked on that sample application. So we had it ready for keynote demo ready. And now it's going through sort of removing all the hard-coded things that we had put in there and making it easier because there is a back-end services and things like that. So we're going to launch like a public API and the public version, so you can just kind of run it locally. Nish is working on a few things so you can deploy things locally too easily. So I'm hoping next week, everyone's on holiday right now, so it has to go through a little code review. But besides that, it's pretty much good to go. But follow the .NET blog. So it's devblogs.microsoft.com/.NET. I don't know if you can post that in there. I don't think I'm an admin, so mine probably got blocked. But you can follow the .NET blog or me on Twitter or Nish on Twitter. We'll tweet it out because that not only has things for the podcast app, but also the backend services, microservices, Blazor, and the hybrid app too. So it has all sorts of good stuff in there. Yeah. So soon. Yeah.
Yeah. Soon. Yeah. We're just finishing a few things, so it should be there.
Yeah, yeah. Open sourcing big projects that you know take some time sometimes. So ideally, we would have had it done, but it was more important for us to have it done for the keynote than that. But surprisingly, the code from the actual source code, like we didn't change anything really, like to be honest with you, between from from like before and after, because it's mostly just us making it a better experience and then removing some hard-coded strings. That's most of the case.
Yeah, I think the most beautiful thing that I find it really exciting is that, you know, just how easy it is to deploy to Azure. So if you have an Azure subscription, just create a resource group and then put in some secrets inside GitHub, and then the GitHub Actions will deploy everything for you. Yeah. And you can start working from there. And then you go and change your code and check in. It just changes and updates. So who knows? I mean, you can create your own podcast app from there, because yeah, we have set everything up correctly for you to go and release this to production, you know?
Totally.
So wait for it. You will have it soon.
Cool.
All right.
So
we
can wait for 2 minutes or 2-3 minutes for questions, if there are any more questions.
I don't know. James, are you okay? Because
yeah,
I know it's too late for
else.
Him. And I don't see it.
Let's wait for one of them if there is any question. Otherwise, you know, Nish, you can go back to your samosas or chai, which I know that you spilled the chai on the table.
Yeah, I spilled my chai.
What was the big thing I got, Nish? I sent you the photo of.
Oh, that's dosa. So
dosa.
Yeah. So James, actually, it looked like a paper masala dosa kind of thing. I mean, it was really big.
Yeah, it's huge.
So it was huge. So James, the dosas that we get here are small.
Okay.
But you specifically asked for something called as paper plain dosa or paper masala dosa, which is like really long.
Yeah.
And if you go for a to-go boxes, like, you know, parcel, we call it here in the US, I think they say to-go, right? So what they do is they actually fold from both the sides like this and then pack it into a smaller thing. It's really nice. Yeah.
So we got a question there.
Sure.
So the question is on like deployment to the store is easy or not. So
it's the same as all the other platforms. So we try to make it easy in the IDE to right click and publish and bundle things up. Android's pretty straightforward. So is Windows as far as certificates, things like that. For iOS, you still need iOS provisioning and certificates. It's still an iOS application. But things like App Center and GitHub Actions are a little bit there. And same thing here for this question, for Android apps to the Play Store or PWA, they're the same. Like if you were going to bundle your PWA into an Android app and release that, it's the same process. To release a PWA, it's part of your website, but then someone needs to click on it. No one installs PWAs as much as they do apps, right? They do, but just not as much as they do apps, because people inherently, I think, they go to the app store to look for apps. When we go on our mobile phones, and maybe this could be cultural too, I don't know, it's different in India, but when you go on your mobile phone and you're like, I'm going to, you know, search for something on Bing or Google, like you are doing that you want to get in and out. Like you don't really want to use the web browser that much. You want to use an app for a specific reason. Now they could be, it's a good option, right? Like if you have an app, like I want to create a better experience, I'll create a PWA. Like you should do that because you can take advantage of stuff. But bring it into the apps or going further there too. So
perfect.
There's one more question as well.
Bruce, rewind and watch what I showed off earlier. But yes, so you have access to all the native APIs in .NET MAUI, but also power to .NET MAUI is something called Essentials, and it has about 60 or 70 or 80 different APIs like connectivity, sensors, geolocation built in. So that's built into .NET MAUI automatically. Yeah.
Right. Nice.
Cool.
We will let you go, James. You know, you need to sleep.
I got to go back to bed.
Thank you for waking up at 3 a.m. and teaching me the MAUI, right? So thank you very much. Teaching the community as well.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Yes. And thanks, Nish, for taking this through, and thanks James for joining in. Thank you all for joining in, and tune in next episode. It's going to be Blazor all through, and we'll have Jeff.
Awesome. Cool. Thanks.
Bye-bye. Take care. Good night.
Take care. Good night, everyone.